So, you know, if you're upset about your culture, well, maybe you could think of some small ways that are local that you could go out and improve it. I think you should start with yourself. Well, then you're only harming yourself and you're not a bad person to practice on. And then you could extend that to your family. Well, at least you suffer for the consequences of your own experiments that way, rather than having someone else do it. And then maybe you can work on bringing a little more harmony into your family. And maybe you can get a job and see if you're any good at that. And then if you manage those three things halfway respectably, well, then you could dare to put a toehold out into the broader community and think, maybe I have an idea here that we could tentatively attempt that might make some small thing slightly better that we could measure carefully and assess. And that would be your contribution. And maybe you get real good at that, you know? So by the time you're 50 or 60 and you have a solid life behind you, you're actually capable of generating large-scale improvements carefully. It's necessary to separate the wheat from the chaff. You know, one of the things I see with readers who are unsophisticated and intellectually arrogant is they'll read someone great. Maybe they'll read Nietzsche, for example, and they'll find the odd thing that Nietzsche said that grates against their current moral sensibilities, whether they do that in context or out. And then they'll throw away the whole book. It's like, you don't throw away the whole book. It was Nietzsche. You don't throw away the book. He's like one in a billion. You read it carefully and you think, well, okay, no to that, but yes to this. And you do the same thing with Dostoevsky, and you do the same thing with Tolstoy. You do the same thing with the great writers of the past that have been passed down to us. You read intelligently. You separate the wheat from the chaff, right? And you gain wisdom that way. Well, you do the same when you look at your own history. It's like, well, of course it's a bloody nightmare. What do you expect? It's like, what's your point? We're going to burn it down and then we're going to have something better as a consequence? Well, not so easily, not so quickly. Maybe we read our history carefully and we think, okay, well, what did we get right? Well, what did we get right? Well, the sovereignty of the individual, that's pretty good. The fact that you have right to property, that's pretty good. You could argue about the limits on that, but you know, you don't want someone just taking your purse. You know, it's helpful that there are things that you can earn and own. You know, the dignity of the individual, that's another one. The innocence before the law, God, that's a miracle that we ever came up with that idea. I can't believe that that idea exists, because in most cultures, it's like, well, you might be guilty. Okay, you're dead. Because, well, that's easier. You might be guilty. You know, why go through all the trouble? There's plenty of people where you came from. It's like the trouble of presuming your innocence. It's innocent. It's even hard for you to do that for yourself. And the idea that each person has an intrinsic worth regardless of their, well, externalities, let's say. That's another idea that's a complete miracle. It's like, well, what are we going to do? We're going to throw all that away with the statement that we live in an oppressive patriarchy. And then we're going to be left with nothing. And what good is that? Well, how about we look at our history and we take responsibility for it? We think, okay, well, here's some things that need to be fixed. There's plenty of them, right? There's plenty of them for each of us to fix. And we'll go fix them. And maybe then we can atone for the bloodiness of our history and for our so-called unearned privilege, you know, some of which all of us have. And that would be good. That would be part of the adventure of your life too. And that's a far more sensible and wise approach to the diagnosis of what's wrong with the West than, well, it's an oppressive patriarchy and it should be overthrown or whatever that, you know, current low resolution and resentful ideology happens to be. You have intrinsic value. And even if you do something terrible, let's say, and I still have the conviction that you have value, then it's incumbent on me to say, well, you did something terrible, but you aren't necessarily something terrible. And it might be possible for you to shed that and to atone and to rejoin those who are good. And that's something too, and that's built deeply into our political and economic and justice systems. And it's no time to be abandoning this. You know, especially when you look around the world, you see as it's spreading, and it's spreading quite rapidly, everywhere it's spreading, things are getting way better. So enough crisis of confidence in the West. Like, we've got our house to put in order. There's no doubt about that. But I see no reason why we can't do it unless we lose faith in ourselves. And there's reason for that. Like, life is brutal. There's reason to lose faith. But not in the final analysis. It's a mark of malevolence and cowardice to lose faith. Without truth, you don't have the adventure of your life. You see, because if you tell the truth, that means you're revealing your being. That's what you're doing when you're telling the truth. And when you reveal your being, then you're living in the world. You're there, you're present, right? That's being there, let's say. That's you. That's your destiny. That's your journey. That's your adventure. That's what's going to justify your life. The adventure. It's not going to be easy. And if you hide from your truth, well, then you hide from yourself. And then you're not even there. And then who the hell are you? What are you? The puppet. You're the puppet of some coward. You're the puppet of some dictator or some second-rate philosopher, some idiotic idea or a bully you were afraid of in grade six. God only knows. But it's not you living your life. And then you lose your life. And you lose your soul too. So that's what I'm afraid of. And so, you know, journalists, well, they try to take me down. It's like, yeah, well, that's annoying. And it usually takes me 3 days to recover. But compared to not having my life and not saying what I have to say, it's nothing. It's minor inconvenience. And then generally, if you can just withstand it, you know, 2 weeks, you get mobbed. You guys might all need to know this. You're going to get mobbed on social media. Okay, so what do you do? Unless you did something wrong. Don't apologize. That's the first thing, because then no one can come to your defense. So don't apologize. Maybe you even double down carefully, carefully, not vengefully, right? Carefully. You say, no, that's what I meant. And if you don't like it, too bad. And you get mobbed. Then you apologize. A different mob comes after you. That's not helpful. And no one can defend you. If you can hold out for 2 weeks, you'll win. Now, it's a pretty brutal 2 weeks because, you know, if you're a reasonable person and 100 angry neighbors show up at your door with pitchforks, you might be thinking there's something wrong with you. You know, like you think that unless you're psychopathic and you think, well, maybe I made a mistake. And it's easy to waver and to back down. And maybe you're also afraid. But, you know, if you scoured your conscience and you're careful and you said what you had to say, then leave it lie. And they'll throw, the people who are playing this game will throw everything they can at you for 2 weeks. And if it doesn't stick, you're done. And then the next time they try it, it doesn't work as well as it did the first time. And by the 50th time they try it, like as far as I can tell, carefully, the people who have enmity for me are out of ammunition. They're done. I read hit pieces now and I think, oh, you just copied the hit piece from 2 months ago. It's like, I'm perfectly habituated to that. They're out of ammunition. And maybe, you know, like, someone creative could still come up with some more ammunition. Maybe that'll happen at the Q&A. But it's not bravery, man. It's faith in the redeeming power of truth. And that's different.